subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. Quad, a multilateral combine of four strong powers across the world, is now rising to the bullying and expansionism of China. In a major ministerial meeting held recently in Japanese capital Tokyo, the USA, Japan, Australia and India acknowledged that countering China's devious tricks of gaining an unethical control over territories in Indo-Pacific was the key issue needed to be addressed today. This comes as a major takeaway as the grouping, which has the caliber of denying China all immoral gains, has so far exercised restraint and has kept its reputation limited to symbolism. Have a look.
The United States, India, Japan, and Australia have taken up a new task. They all have braced themselves to show China its real place. In a multilateral meeting held recently in Tokyo, the foreign ministers of all four countries decided to not only impede Chinese expansionism, but to also counter its exploitative designs that had lately held smaller countries in the region hostage to its plans. US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo said, "It was more critical now than ever for the regional allies in Indo-Pacific to collaborate against what he called Chinese Communist Party's exploitation, coercion, and corruption."
As partners in this Quad, it is more critical now than ever that we collaborate to protect our people and partners from the CCP's exploitation, corruption, and coercion.
While Washington has been looking to build support among Asian allies against Beijing, analysts have said China's neighbors want to avoid a direct confrontation because of economic ties. Under such situation, it was incumbent upon powerful nations to rein in Chinese aggression. Quad appears most stable, powerful, and prepared grouping in such times. This growing assertiveness of these nations has already spooked China, and it has denounced the grouping's stance as an attempt to contain its development. However, the Quad, which is a more credible grouping than China on any given day, says that it had a positive agenda and wanted to see a rule-based order in the region.
This important step in the continuing evolution of the Quad signals our steadfast commitment to working together to promote an open, inclusive, and resilient Indo-Pacific. The Quad has a positive agenda. It's a diplomatic network that assists us as democracies to align ourselves in support of shared interests. We believe in a region governed by rules, not power.
It is not just the Quad where China is facing resistance and a challenge from. In the Indo-Pacific region alone, Beijing is at loggerheads with as many as 17 countries. While it has been claiming waters of 10 nations, it has made illegal territorial claims against 7 sovereign states. However, it has been called out and challenged by even smaller nations like Vietnam. The country's PLA has even suffered successive setbacks at Indian border, with Indian Army handing it defeat at multiple strategic points in past couple of months. The Quad aims to ensure rule-based, free and open international border.
我々4カ国は民主主義、法の支配、自由経済といった基本的な価値観を共有し、地域において責任を有するパートナーとして、ルールに基づく自由で開かれた国際秩序を強化していくという目的を共有しています。この目標に向けて大きな役割を果たすのが自由で開かれたインド太平洋構想であります。
While on one side China is accused by countries around the world of human rights violations inside its own territory, on other, they all have made observations about its growing expansionism across the country. A group of 39 countries led by Germany recently condemned China for its atrocities in the country's northwestern Xinjiang. While China has failed in convincing others that the coronavirus wasn't manufactured in labs, its nefarious plots have further deepened the mistrust among the international community.
We are now joined by Anil Trigunayath, a former Indian diplomat and a distinguished fellow at an Indian think tank. So, Mr. Trigunayath, how do you analyze the recent meeting of the Quad? And do you think Quad can ensure a rule-based order in the region and deny China a regional hegemony?
The basic purpose of this was essentially to review the global situation, review the regional situation in the Indo-Pacific, as well as to also discuss the possibilities of further collaboration in countering the hegemonistic agenda of certain countries. Of course, for the United States, China is the main adversary. As far as India is concerned, we have seen that for the last 4 or 5 months, the Chinese are grabbing our territory and are posturing, aggressing into India. They have done so in Japan. They have done so against the Australians. So therefore, as far as the bullying and hegemonism of the Chinese is concerned, I believe that the countries are looking at the possibility because, see, the unhindered movement through the seas is extremely important for every country and for every nation around the world for free trade. And so, therefore, rule-based order, the freedom of navigation are extremely important parts of this enterprise. Now, it is essential that Quad, of course, cannot be called a military alliance. Even though all the countries in the region are conducting exercises or trying to align their interoperabilities and have signed various agreements to this effect. So that is very much there. But at the same time, as far as India is concerned, it is not against China. It is not against anybody. It is for a rule-based order. And I'm quite sure when the four powers, which are major powers in the world and are democracies on top of it, stand up and say something like that, I'm quite sure that the Chinese will listen, the rest of the world will listen, Europeans are supporting it, everybody else is supporting this initiative. So therefore, there is no reason that the Chinese will continue to stand in this manner and be affront, which is not advisable for them. Their vulvarian diplomacy has actually done them more harm than good. They have lost a lot of friendships. And their credibility on top of it, not only because of the coronavirus pandemic, but at the same time, the way that they have handled the global relationships and tried to create their hegemony. So I'm quite confident that gradually as the build-up, the Quad or Quad Plus for that matter, is going to be a major alignment, if not an alliance, to reckon with in the region, and should provide a mirror to the Chinese.
Moving on, massive anti-establishment protests have resurfaced in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan. People are demanding the release of Babajan and other renowned political activists and leaders who they say have been falsely implicated and sentenced to rigorous imprisonment. They accuse Pakistan of systematically exploiting the region of its resources and sharing no dividends with them. Any resistance, they say, meets brutal government reprisal, with activists and leaders hounded, arrested and tortured.
A wave of anger has swept towns and villages across the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan after the Stooge administration launched a crackdown against the political activists. Dissenting political leaders and anybody who hasn't fallen in line with the arbitrary orders of the government. People across the region have taken to streets and are demanding immediate release of activists who have been falsely implicated and awarded rigorous punishment. Carrying pictures of Babajan, a prominent local activist cum leader serving a 90-year sentence on trumped-up charges, and shouting anti-establishment slogans, people said that the government had grown fearful of the growing resistance in the region. People in Gilgit-Baltistan say that Pakistan is rattled by its expose at the Global Forum for its increasingly authoritarian attitude.
ये जो हमारे जो भाई हैं जो पिछले 9 सालों से तकरीबन जेलों के सलाखों के पीछे हैं, कैद और बंद की सोबतें बर्दाश्त कर रहे हैं, इनकी बात कहां नहीं पहुंची, इनकी आवाज कहां तक नहीं गई, इस मसले को यूनाइटेड नेशन ने अपनी रिपोर्ट में भी दर्ज किया। यूएन कमीशन की, ह्यूमन राइट्स कमीशन की रिपोर्ट में भी यह वाकया जिक्र हुआ, इस जुल्म का जिक्र हुआ जो गिलगित पाकिस्तान के हमारे भाइयों के साथ हो रहा।
Leaders have now appealed the youth of the region to remain united against the barbarity of the establishment. They say the establishment is planning a systematic elimination of all the voices that posed it a challenge.
पंजाब से ब्यूरोक्रेसी आकर हमारे लोगों को टारगेट करके दबाया जाता है। आज हमारे लोगों की बिजनेस मफलूज है, आज हमारे छोटे कारोबारी तबका वो भी मफलूज का शिकार है, आज हमारे यहाँ के मेहनत कश तबके के घरों में फाके पड़ चुके हैं। हमें उठना होगा, नहीं तो एक एक करके हमें इसी तरह सिसक सिसक के ये मार देंगे। आपको कमर किसके खड़ा होना होगा?
जब लाल लाल लहराएगा,
तब और सिकंदर आएगा।
जब लाल लाल लहराएगा,
तब और सिकंदर आएगा।
The local leaders who do not find adequate mention in daily publication and news channels have also asked people to gather in even greater numbers in the coming time. They say an intensified movement was the only way to ensure release of their fellow citizens. They have asked the authorities to release all of them before scheduled elections of 15th November. Pakistan has for decades been plundering the region of its land and resources and been giving it nearly zero returns. Demanding rights has seemingly become an unwritten crime in Gilgit-Baltistan. Anybody who has dared raise his voice against the discrimination has been subject to intimidation, arrest and imprisonment.
Babajan! Babajan!
Moving on. The Himalayan nation of Nepal, which is registering a record rise in its COVID load case every day, is staring at a possible lockdown in coming times. Kathmandu had imposed strict restrictions in the immediate aftermath of the global outbreak of the pandemic, but is now finding it hard to contain the spread owing to multiple reasons. The weak health system is overwhelmed and people have grown desperate. While some do not have an option but to move out to earn living, others have still not realized the gravity of the threat virus poses to humanity. Result, cases surging rapidly.
China's neighbor Nepal, 65 times smaller its size with 45 times less population, has surpassed it in the number of total COVID cases it has reported so far. And now, with situation gradually going out of control in a weak and overwhelmed healthcare system of the country, the government might impose a fresh lockdown. Earlier, to curb the spread of the virus, the Himalayan nation had enforced a nationwide lockdown in March that put its 30 million citizens restricted to their homes, halting all economic operations. People do not want to witness such times once again, as they say their personal and professional lives were deeply affected in those months. They have still not recovered the losses they suffered in those times.
अब यसको लागि चाहिँ सरकारले चाहिँ सकेसम्म चाहिँ तपाईको कस्तो भने अब लकडाउनले त धेरै असर परेको नै छ हैन अब त्यसको अलावा चाहिँ हामीले आफै सुरक्षित भएर अब भनम न दूरी कायम गरेर भिडभाडमा धेरै नगएर मास्कहरू लगाएर अनि आफू चाहिँ सुरक्षित रहेर त्यो गरे भने चाहिँ हुन्छ त्यसमा चाहिँ कन्ट्रोल ल्याउन सकिन्छ नभएर यो लकडाउन गर्यो यताउति गर्यो भने त फेरि जनताहरू त फेरि त्यही पुरानै स्थितिमा फर्किन फेरि बाध्य हुन्छ त्यही भएर गाह्रो नै हुन्छ लकडाउनको चाहिँ एकदमै मार पर्छ लकडाउनले
Experts say that it was the grave need of resumption of economic activities that once again made the entire nation more vulnerable to the disease. While some are at risk due to their indispensable professional commitments, others few have been blatantly irresponsible. Health experts say that there are many in the country who have still not realized the threat posed by the pandemic that has already claimed more than a million people world over. While the country was recording the cases in dozens during lockdown, the daily tally touches thousands now. Everybody from a common man to PM office is affected. Three advisors to Nepal's Prime Minister, KP Sharma Oli, have been tested positive. Many across the country believe that strict adherence to the social distancing norms and masks and sanitizers can keep Corona at bay and things might improve with time.
अब जस्तै यस्तो छ हाम्रो लकडाउन पनि लामै समयसम्म रह्यो होइन तर लकडाउन मात्रै पनि एउटा समाधान होइन मान्छे आफैमा सचेत हुनुपर्छ जस्तो लाग्छ जस्तो सोसल डिस्टान्सिङको कुरा छ सेनिटाइजेसनको कुरा छ होइन अब हामीले एकदम भिड यहाँ देखिरहेका छौँ मान्छेहरू कोही त अब मास्क नलाइकन पनि हिँडिरहनु भएको छ गभर्मेन्टको स्टेप एकातिर छ भने मान्छे आफैमा पनि सचेत हुँदा चाहिँ यो अलिकति कन्ट्रोल हुन्थ्यो कि जस्तो मलाई लाग्छ
Meanwhile, Russia's sovereign wealth fund has agreed to supply 25 million doses of its potential COVID-19 vaccine to Nepal. the Russian Direct Investment Fund has struck multiple Sputnik V vaccine supply deals abroad, including to supply 100 million doses to India, where it also expects to hold clinical trials. Neighboring India has also supported Nepal by sending tons of medicines and medical equipments. China, on the other side, which calls itself an ally of Nepal, has not been committed enough in lending a helping hand. Else, countries like Nepal, that are very small in size and population, could have been saved by those who are the originator of the virus and have contained it under 100,000 cases.
Moving on, Ladakh, a mountainous region and a union territory in the North India, is set to be a heaven for adventurers. Bike riders from all corners of India and other countries visit the Himalayan region to ride on rough and hilly terrains and enjoy a fun-filled experience. Recently, a two-day biking festival was organized in Ladakh, where adventure lovers participated with great zeal and enthusiasm. Let's have a look.
Wearing safety gears, these bike junkies gathered to participate in a two-day mountain biking festival in the Himalayan territory of Ladakh. The event was aimed to promote and diversify the scope of tourism in the region. Riding specially designed bikes, these bikers explored the rugged mountains all in the backdrop of the snow-capped Himalayas. The main idea behind the event flourished with the specific goal of encouraging the locals, especially the younger generation, to get involved in the adventure sports and also to develop the region into a top mountain biking destination in the country. Every year, many cyclists participate in the event, but this year, due to the coronavirus outbreak, it was organized on a smaller scale.
इतने हाई एल्टीट्यूड पे आई डोंट थिंक कोई भी रेस वर्ल्ड में होती है तो अगर यहाँ पे एक वर्ल्ड क्लास इवेंट किया जाए तो सबके लिए एक नया चैलेंज रहेगा इतने एल्टीट्यूड पे जब पेडलिंग करना पड़ेगा तो आपका ब्रीदिंग टेक्निक एवरीथिंग विल मैटर तो हाई एल्टीट्यूड के ऊपर डेफिनेटली सबके लिए इट विल बी अ चैलेंजिंग फॉर वर्ल्ड क्लास एथलीट्स ऑल्सो इट विल बी अ चैलेंजिंग एक्सपीरियंस एंड इट विल डेफिनेटली बी अ फन
Extreme adventure enthusiasts paddled through several high-altitude mountain passes, namely Rohtang Pass at an altitude of 3,980 meters, followed by Baralacha Pass at 4,892 meters, Lachungla Pass at 5,065 meters, and finally Tanglang Pass at 5,360 meters. The festival invited both professional and amateur riders to participate in the event from across the country. However, only a few could make it to the final round. At the event, organizers said they hope to draw bikers from across the world for adventure tourism in the region, which is mostly dependent on local agriculture and cultural tourism.
So this is the day two of Ladakh Mountain Biking Festival in which is organized by the Tourism Department of the UT Ladakh in collaboration with Altoa and Unexplored Ladakh. Well, this is the second day of the event and today we are going to have the downhill section of it. And we have around 10 to 15 participants and out of which 8 of them are from the outside professional riders which have been invited specifically for this event. Well, basically this is for a promotional, for mountain biking promotional in tourism sense. So this is to diversify the tourism industry in Ladakh and mountain biking fits perfectly in it.
Such type of activities offer immense opportunities to encourage adventure tourism in the region. Located in the deserts of the Himalayan region, Ladakh is one of the highest inhabited places in the world above sea level.
Indeed, Ladakh is a paradise for adventure lovers and one must visit for breathtaking sports activities. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Take care and stay healthy.